There has been some kind of a universal system at use in the ancient world. And these various cultural groups, whether it was the Egyptians or Sumerians or Mayans or the Hopewellians or the megalithic builders, had access to some universal system from some source that was outside their own cultural context. And I suggest that the source of that goes back into deep time, that takes us back beyond the threshold of known history into the realm of mythical history, which means we're going back like into the Ice Age, back into the Pleistocene, to use the geologist term, back into the deep recesses of the human tenure on planet Earth, whose only memory has come down to us, not in the form of recorded history, but in the form of myth and epic story and legend and so forth. Because as it turns out, if we, and this is again is a good topic for the sacred geometry class, when we analyze Plato's description of Atlantis, Plato basically gave the date of the sinking of Atlantis as 9,000 years prior to Solon, the Egyptian, the Athenian poet and statesman. Solon did a 10-year exile in Egypt. And it was Solon that brought back the tale of Atlantis and presented it to the Greeks. And Solon basically made that journey around 600 BC. So if you add the 9,000 years to the 600 BC, we come up with a date of about 11,600 years ago for Plato's date for the demise of Atlantis. Well, it's very interesting that the date 11,600 years has been independently discovered by geologists looking at the tempo of various catastrophes that have occurred on Earth. And to those catastrophes is where I'm now going to turn. Catastrophes in the time of man, the tempo of global change. What I've done here is I put a time bar that goes from the present right here. This is us now. This is today. Right here is May 3rd at 4 o'clock. Is it 4 o'clock? That's right here. And this is 150,000 years ago. And the reason I used 150,000 years is that some of the earliest skeletal remains ever discovered of modern humans date back to 150 to even to 180,000 years. Skeletons that appear to be indistinguishable from a modern skeleton, which suggests that modern humans with presumably equivalent intelligence to our own were present on the planet at least this far back. So here we've got a 150,000 year time span. You'll notice this little red bar at the end. That red bar represents the span of recorded history, which is basically the advent of Sumerian cuneiform writing. So if it turns out that there were modern humans living through this whole span of time, why is there no history? Well, now you got to do is turn to these various things that I've put on here. These are events that have occurred. And I used a certain criteria for these events. And here's the criteria I used. I began studying the record of geological change, climate change, environmental change, and I focused on events that could be considered catastrophic. And catastrophic to the extent that were an event of an equivalent magnitude to occur now, it would basically end civilization as we know it. That's the criteria I use. What would be the magnitude of an event that it would take to terminate our modern industrial civilization? That's the criteria that I used. Then I began to search through the record of all of the events that would be of that magnitude or greater. And the events that I found so far have been entered onto this graph, and they're listed all here. You can see them. And how many do we have here? And this is not complete necessarily, but we have at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 of them in 150,000 years. So at least 16 times in the last 150,000 years, there have been climate or environmental or geological catastrophes powerful enough that were they to occur today, would essentially put us back into the Stone Age. Would essentially, if you think about some of the small catastrophes we have seen in the last few years, from the destruction of New Orleans to the great tsunami, you know, to some of the big earthquakes that we've seen, you know, New Orleans is still not recovered. But you've got to imagine what would happen if an event that was one order of magnitude greater than Katrina happened. By that I mean 10 times worse. Let's say that we had 10 cities decimated to the extent of New Orleans. We could certainly recover from that, but it would be a major effort to do so. Now what if we were talking about two orders of magnitude? Let's say, to put it into a rough equivalency, an event that could cause the decimation of 100 major urban areas. Could we recover from that? Questionable. Now let's go three orders of magnitude. And now we're talking about the equivalent of 1,000 major cities completely decimated. Okay, at that level, three orders of magnitude, that's what these are. Those are events that essentially would be three orders of magnitude. Once you begin to ponder this, it becomes apparent why there isn't a record, an extant record of what's been going on for the whole time that we humans have been here. Now, at this point, you probably haven't tied this in with what we've been saying before, other than I'll point out a few things to you that should be. Onset of the late Wisconsin Ice Age, 26,000 years before present. Remember the great year and the processional cycle? Add about 80 years to that, and we've got 26,000. Of course, 26,000, you could figure plus or minus a few centuries. Now, you come through that cosmic clock that I showed you, right? Halfway to the cusp of the age of Leo. 12,900 years ago, roughly. And what happened? We have something that happened. 12,900 years before present, onset of the Younger Dryas climate catastrophe, first phase of the megafaunal extinctions. Now here what I've done is I've entered some green dots. Now look at what the green dots are. The green dots are basically derived directly from the model of the Great Year, based upon cycles of 6,480, 12,960, and then 25,920. And you'll notice how high of a correlation there is between the tempo of events, the actual events that have been derived by scientists without any reference to this Great Year model at all, and the timing of these ages of the world. Remember the 6,480 years, that was the bull, the lion, the eagle, and the man. And according to the traditions, each of those seasons of the Great Year is inaugurated by some type of a great event, a transformative event, a catastrophe, if you will. And what I've done here is I have developed a data set that shows the correlation. It certainly seems from a study of this graph that these intervals, these event nodes as I call them, the susceptibility of something happening goes up exponentially for a short period of time. Here's the analogy that I have used. You're out driving along a quiet country road, you've got it on, you know, cruise control, you're kicking back, you're listening to some tunes, you're not paying much attention, you know, you're talking on your cell phone, not much traffic. Okay, now you come up to a major highway. Cars are like this. Well, you're crossing that intersection, and while you're crossing that intersection, now suddenly you got to put your cell phone down and start paying attention, because if you don't, you're going to get T-boned, right? Well, obviously, you've got your whole journey, and each time you cross an intersection of a major highway, you know, the potential of a catastrophe increases considerably over what it would be while you're out there on the lonely country road. Well, you see, our planet is on a cosmic highway around the galaxy. And we're now beginning to understand the fine structure of the galaxy, and we realize that there is a pattern and an order to it. And there's a tempo of these orbital revolutions. There's a tempo of the galaxy. And there's a wave pattern of the Earth moving up and down, above and below the galactic plane. And within that, there are suborbital cycles as well. And we also discover that there seems to be a tempo in the delivery of cosmic matter to the inner solar system. It doesn't seem to be random. And this is going to be beyond the scope of today's lecture, but what I'm getting at here is that the evidence now supports the conclusion that the delivery of cosmic material and energy, the energy pulses that would be affecting Earth, are non-random. That they are on some kind of a cosmic timetable, a cosmic tempo, if you will. And I think this is one of the most important insights we get from these ancient traditions, is the measurement of cosmic time and how it relates to us here on Earth. You just got to know what to look for and where to look for it. Once you begin to become aware of it and you begin to see it, you begin to realize that the cosmic fingerprints are everywhere about us. We're in fact living in and upon the wreckage of the former worlds. The rubble of these former worlds is all around us, but we haven't had the scale of perspective to see it. And that's where we're at now. I'm completely thrilled with things like the emergence of Google Earth, because Google Earth is now allowing us to just somebody, all of us, to sit at our computers and see the cosmic perspective of Earth. And when you look at it from, you know, from the extraterrestrial point of view, things begin to show up that we don't see when we're right down here immersed on it so close that we're like ants walking under rubble and can't see what's around us. But we do see that we literally have built our own world and our own social system on top of and out of the wreckage of former worlds.